is peace that outlasts darkness and hope that's in the blood. The future grace is mine today that Jesus Christ has won. So I can face tomorrow, for tomorrow's in your hands. All I need you will provide, just like you always have. I'm fighting a battle you've already won. No matter what comes my way, I will overcome. Don't know what you're doing, but I know what you've done. I'm fighting a battle you've already won. Mercy in the waiting and manna for today. And when it's done, I know you're not. You are my hope and stay. And when the sea is raging, your spirit is my help. He'll fix my eyes on Jesus Christ and say that it is well. Oh, I know that it is well. I'm fighting a battle you've already won. No matter what comes my way, I will overcome. I don't know what you're doing, but I know what you've done. I'm fighting a battle you've already won. I know how the story ends. We will be with you again. You're my Savior, my defense. No more fear in life or death. Oh, I know how the story ends. We will be with you again. You're my Savior, my defense. No more fear in life or death. I know how the story ends. I'm fighting a battle you've already won. No matter what comes my way, I will overcome. I don't know what you're doing, but I know what you've done. I'm fighting a battle you've already won.
All my attempts to be satisfied, vain and empty, until the moment you rescued me and your love filled me. My soul sings, now my soul sings. What blessed assurance I've found in you, I've found in you. I won't be shaken, I will not be moved. How steadfast your strong hand is keeping me, I won't be shaken, I will not be moved. Oh, blessed assurance.
No other love that I've ever known compares to you, God. No other love that I've ever found done what you've done.
My soul sings, now my soul sings. What blessed assurance I found in you, I found in you. I won't be shaken, I will not be moved. How steadfast your strong hand is keeping me, I won't be shaken, I will not be moved. Oh, blessed assurance.
Ever my anchor, ever my strength, ever my portion and all I need, ever my healing, ever my hope, ever the truth that leads me home, that leads me home. What blessed assurance I found in you, I found in you. I won't be shaken, I will not be moved. How steadfast your strong hand is keeping me, I won't be shaken, I will not be moved. Oh, blessed assurance.
Thank you, Jesus.
You are the most handsome of all. Gracious words stream from your lips. God himself has blessed you forever. Put on your sword, O mighty warrior. You are so glorious, so majestic. In your majesty, ride out to victory, defending truth, humility, and justice.
Amen.
Go forth to perform awe-inspiring deeds. Your arrows are sharp, piercing your enemies' hearts. The nations fall before you, lying down beneath your feet. Your throne, O God, endures forever and ever. Your royal power is expressed in justice. You love what is right and hate what is wrong. Hallelujah, Lord, we worship you, for you are our God. Your throne endures forever in truth and justice and righteousness.
Blessed be your name, the land that is plentiful, where streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name.
Blessed be your name.
When I'm found in the desert place, when I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name.
Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And then the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name.
Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all that it should be, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name, the road marked with suffering, there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away, you give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. You give and take away, you give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name.
My
the sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are, and where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Yes, where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me.
Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you.
Teach my song to rise to you.
When temptation comes my way,
when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you.
Jesus, you're my hope and stay. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Hey, Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you.
You're my one defense,
my righteousness, oh God, how I need you.
Morning.
Good morning.
It's very good to see you this morning, and to you online. Hi, Mom. You think I'm joking? Okay. If you just give me a minute, not really a minute. Indulge with me for a second here. I will be with you. So, we have a piece of paper here, okay? So what if I take this piece of paper and I say, fly, be free? It doesn't really fly too good, does it? No. I was thinking Isaac Newton might be wrong, but he's not. Okay. What about if I leave it in its original form here, like this? I don't crumple it. Is it gonna fly? Some of you aren't quite sure. Okay, all right. I gotta do this for the camera, you know? Okay, so it doesn't. A little floating, but not flying. Okay, so but what if I take the piece of paper, and I fold it here and I fold it there. And some of the guys are thinking, well, I can make a better one than that. Well, that's fine. You can show me later. Okay, so here it is. It's a little bit different. I mean, it's the same kind of piece of paper, right? It's same weight and all that sort of stuff. Is it going to fly now? Maybe. Okay, I don't want to poke anybody in the eye, so we're going to go this way. All right? Onyx! Okay. Yeah. Okay. It flew. Okay. All right. So now we're thankful for gravity right now. Okay. You know, it helps us not to float around like you've seen the astronauts and what they do, right? Yeah. We don't want to do that. So, and it causes all sorts of problems. Just ask an astronaut. But the paper flew. And the reason the paper flew, to make it simple, yeah, is because it was shaped aerodynamically, and it was helped by the power or the thrust, for those of you that, you know, are more particular, right, of me throwing the airplane, right? And so before it was subject to the law of gravity, but when certain conditions are met, it's made aerodynamically, it has some thrust, then the law of aerodynamics kicks in, which helps the paper to overcome the law of gravity, okay? Indulge with me some more, please. This is an Airbus A380, and I don't work for Airbus, okay? And the law of gravity keeps that thing on the ground. That is the largest non-military aircraft in the world. It weighs 575 tons. And some of you are like, well, how heavy is that? Well, if you think like me, that's 322 CRVs, the Cyprus Retirement Vehicle, okay? And that plane holds up to 853 passengers on its double decks, yep. The weight of its external paint alone, just the paint on the plane, that's 531 kg. Okay? So the law of gravity holds that in place while we're getting on board, and we're thankful for that, okay? You know, could you imagine? It's like, hey, Jim, did you forget to tie the Airbus down again? Gosh, we've lost another one. You know, it just floats off, okay? No, we've got gravity, okay? But what happens when that plane's four massive jet engines, for you British people, some are produced by Rolls-Royce, okay? So others are not, okay? And the pilot and the computer technology and everything, they all do their jobs. Well, then that huge thing, it gets off the ground. Tons of metal, electronic components, wiring, seats, luggage, hundreds of people. And it's off the ground, and then it just kind of glides through the air. Why? Well, because those certain conditions were met, that the law of gravity was superseded by the law of aerodynamics. And any of you that travel by plane are very thankful for the law of aerodynamics, yeah? Well, you and I are a little bit like those pieces of paper or an Airbus. And no, I'm not saying some of you are skinny and some of you are a little bit bigger. That's not what I'm saying, okay? Turn to Romans chapter 8, please. Romans chapter 8 is where we are in the Bible. That was really quick turning. You guys are on it. Good. And I'm just going to pray for our time in God's word. I'm going to read to you a larger portion than really we're going to look at, just for some context. But let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you that it is truth. We thank you that it's alive by your spirit. And Lord, just ask that by your grace and your mercy that you would help me to communicate what you desire to this morning. Lord, that we would have ears to hear what your spirit is saying, that it would be very applicable. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. So beginning in verse 1, I'm reading from the ESV. It's okay if you've got a different translation. It says, There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do. By sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who work, not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on things of the Spirit. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God. You, however, speaking of those in Christ, you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If in fact the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. Okay. All right, well, we've just read from the middle part of Paul's letter to the Romans. That means that there's seven chapters leading up to this eighth chapter. And in those chapters, it has been clearly shown that each and every one of us are natural born sinners. Sorry, but it's true. We sin naturally because we have inherited a sinful nature from our original parents who sinned against God in the garden long ago. Yeah. And it has been demonstrated, as Paul has been going through in the previous chapters, that all of humanity has been affected by and actively participate in sin, as it declares, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Everybody. And, well, maybe you're, I don't know, you're questioning that this morning, that you think, well, maybe you've never sinned. Let me ask you, have you ever lied? And you respond and say, no. There we go. Okay. We can talk more later, right? Right? Our sin, such as lying, coveting, stealing, having impure thoughts and motives, results in us being guilty before God and condemned by his law. The law is not bad, just like the law of gravity is not bad. The law is designed to show us the difference between that which is good and holy and pure and that which is bad, unholy, impure, sinful. Yeah? The law shows us our sin. It also condemns us and lets us know that as sinners, that we have earned to be judged and punished for our sin. Earlier in this letter, we're told that the payment that we have earned, that we actually earn this by our sin, isn't something that you want to collect on payday, because it's death. Romans 6:23. For the wages, the wage that you earn by your sin, is nothing good. It is death. So, because of our sin, you and me, all of humanity, yeah, according to the law, which is right, we have earned being condemned to face judgment of death, physical, spiritual, eternal. Condemned with no way in ourselves of escaping the judgment of our sin, which we have earned, our own wage. Yeah. There's absolutely nothing that we can do in ourselves, no religious works or ritual that we can do to change our standing before God, condemned by the law of God. Like that piece of paper that, you know, it just, it cannot in itself, it cannot free itself from the law of gravity. It just can't. It can't do it. Now, this truth regarding the law and our sin, Paul summarizes in what we just read here in Romans chapter 8. He calls that the law of sin and death. So without Jesus, you and I, all of us, condemned, facing judgment under the law of sin and death. We were without hope, no means to change ourselves, to save ourselves. I don't know how many of you have tried to make yourself better. And maybe you were successful, started eating a little bit better, yeah, maybe exercising, that sort of thing. Yeah. But it didn't get you too far, especially in regards to the law of God. Without Jesus, we are bound and we are subject to the downward pull of the law of sin and death. Outside of Christ, we were a lot like that crumpled piece of paper that I showed you first. Yep. Subject to the law of gravity, it falls. The flat piece of paper, even if we were just left in our original state, our original state is being a sinner, unable to pull itself away from the law of sin and death. Just like that flat piece of paper can't in itself start to fly. I mean, maybe something can help it to float, but in itself, it can't do it. Grounded by the law of gravity and us, grounded because of our sins, which are many, if we're honest, if we know ourselves, grounded and condemned by the law of sin and death. Okay, let's stop there. We're done. Wouldn't that be great? No. Thankfully, there is another law at work. Just as there is the law of aerodynamics, which overcomes the law of gravity, allowing the little airplane to fly or the great giant A380 fly, yep, there is a law that supersedes and can overcome the law of sin and death when the right conditions are met. And we're told here that this law, he summarizes it as this. In the translation I'm reading, it's called the law of the spirit of life. In other translations, it says the law of the spirit of life in Christ Jesus. Speaking of the same thing. Yeah. So, similar to the pieces of paper, or the piece of paper that I folded, right? So that it could be set free from the law of gravity, because it's been shaped aerodynamically and thrown, given energy enabling it to fly according to the law of aerodynamics. Well, if you're in Christ this morning, if you've accepted Jesus as your Savior, the Holy Spirit came to dwell within you and to free you from being bound by the sin or the law of sin and death and its downward pull upon you. By the grace of God, in the power of God, we were set free to fly according to the law of the spirit of life in Christ. Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians 15:56. the sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone, anyone, you got it, anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. The new has come. One of the amazing and essential benefits that we attain according to the law of the Spirit of life is that we are no longer under condemnation, condemned under the law of sin and death. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. When? Next week, when I live really good, all my thoughts are pure. Yeah. Oh, next week when I, you know, or next month when I make it to church on time every Sunday? Or, no, not till Jesus comes back. Well, actually, it says now. And, you know, some of you, I wonder what that means in the Greek. Like, let's look it up. Well, I did. It means now. Just so you know. As it is, presently. Right now. Okay? This very moment, no matter how you're feeling or how challenging your morning has been so far, or how much you're very aware that there's much more spiritual growth needed in your life, if you are in Jesus Christ, there is no condemnation for you. Now, presently. Okay, condemnation, it's a word. Okay, what does it mean? Penalty, punishment, or judgment. I don't like that word. It doesn't sound nice. Yeah. And this kind of condemnation, it implies a condemning that leads to judgment without the possibility of pardon. Like back in jolly old England. I don't know when it was very jolly. But in the Middle Ages, you could possibly meet this guy. And as you were being led to him, there was no way for you to go anywhere else but to him. Why? Because you were a condemned prisoner who was going to be executed because you were condemned. No possibility of pardon. Done. Well, in Christ, there is no longer any condemning judgment, punishment for you. The punishment that you and I rightly deserve because of our many sins, which the law of sin and death has against us, has been dealt with by our Savior, Jesus, who has set us free from the law of sin and death and established the law of the Spirit of life in him. Verse 3, it says, "For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do, by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh for sin. He condemned sin in the flesh." The law could not save us. It could only show us our guilt. It could only condemn us. God knew this. And God, who is love himself, sent God the Son, Jesus, who took upon himself perfect humanity in order to give that life of perfection upon the cross for you and for me. A perfect and complete sacrifice. Yeah? Paying for your sins and mine. All of them. Completely. Even that really terrible thing that you did? Or what about that stuff that you did behind closed doors that nobody knew about? Or that stuff that's rattled around in your head? Those murderous thoughts. Those lustful thoughts. Those curses that you have uttered. Blasphemy. Well, every single one. In Christ, covered by his sacrifice. And upon receiving Christ as our Lord and Savior, we have been credited with his righteousness to our account. Being clothed in our righteousness and indwelt by the Holy Spirit, we have been set free from the judgment we once deserved. That judgment. The law of the Spirit of life has set us free from the judgment we deserve under the law of sin and death. So now, in Christ, there is no condemning judgment or punishment for you. Is that good news?
Amen. Excellent. Praise God.
Is it? I hope there's people here. That is great news.
Amen.
And great is an understatement. Especially if we remember that there was no way for us to deal with that in ourselves. None. Yeah. Like those pieces of paper, powerless in themselves to free themselves from the law of gravity. The only way of escape was by accepting Jesus and the newness of life, the forgiveness that he offers, the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, setting us free by the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus, which makes us a new creation, right? And molds us and shapes us and folds us like that paper. So that we can fly, be a bit more like Jesus until we see him face to face, and we will be like him. Well, not only have we been set free from God's condemning judgment, we have also been set free from the condemnation that the devil likes to accuse us with, or the self-condemnation that some of us are really good at putting on ourselves. Don't need the devil's help. We're really good at it. Do you know that one of the names that the devil is given in the scriptures is the accuser of the brethren? And one of the demonic host's most common methods of attacking believers is to accuse them with condemning thoughts and feelings. Sometimes using other people to just share their condemnation as well. The devil and his demons, they are accusers of believers. You and I, this morning. And one of their favorite tactics is to try to get us to a point where we are so self-condemned over our sin committed in the past, committed in the present, or even things we haven't even done, that we feel like we can't be a Christian anymore. To condemn us, to play upon our emotions, to make us feel down. So condemned that we feel like we can no longer pray, or that we can no longer hear from God in his word. Our enemy is very good at reminding us of the things that we did before accepting Jesus. Those things perhaps that nobody else knows about, but we remember. And he will remind you of those things, seeking to cause you to question, has God really forgiven me? Could he really forgive that? Surely God doesn't want anything to do with me. And he may whisper thoughts in your ear or whatever, or inspire others just to tell you to your face, condemning you. I shared this at the Foundations class this week. I used to go out on the streets of York every Friday evening with my buddy Graham and share the gospel. You know, the pub crawlers, the heroin addicts, and everybody else in between. And on this particular Friday evening, we're out there and we're sharing. And Graham was a very gifted evangelist. He had been a skateboarder in his previous life and had lived a skateboarder lifestyle. If you don't know what that means, partying is involved. Partying is involved. And other things, okay? Well, on this particular night, we were sharing with some people, and a group of young women started to come past, and one of them saw Graham and recognized him from his pre-Christian days in the city of Bradford. And she realized what we were doing pretty quickly, and she started shouting at Graham, reminding him of the person he had been. What a hypocrite he was now. How could he be telling people about Jesus? Her language was foul, and she brought many specific things to mind. And I was just praying, and Graham was looking down, his head was down. As he listened, and then he looked up with a smile, and he said, "That's no longer who I am. For Jesus has forgiven me and changed me." And he started sharing the gospel. It was great. Our enemy seeks to condemn us over our sins of the past. He's quite good at pointing out our failures of after we came to Jesus, reminding us of how we've fallen after accepting him as Savior. You know, saying to you, how could you do that? You call yourself a Christian. There's no way that you really know God. You need to give this up. You're not fooling anybody. I've never had these thoughts, just so you know. There are times when it seems like the enemy is right there when we fail. And he's very quick. Look what you just did. You're no Christian. Can see right through you. What a hypocrite you are. You need to go back to your old life. Be real with everybody. That's who you really are. And like I said before, some of us, we don't really need the enemy to whisper into our own ears. We're just really good at condemning ourselves, you know. I'm not doing enough for God. Such a loser, you know. I've made a mess again. I haven't walked on water this week. Well, we must remember, and we must stand upon the truth that is declared to us here. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. There is no condemning judgment for you and I in Christ. No valid condemnation from the enemy or from ourselves. We have been set free according to the law of spirit of life in Christ Jesus. Set us free from any condemning judgment upon us because Jesus has already paid for it. Past sin, present sin, future sin, done at the cross. In regards to our lives before Christ and the things that we did before accepting him, they were taken care of when we came to Jesus. Forgiven. When we accepted him as our Savior and turned from our sin. Colossians 2:13. In you, who were dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made alive together with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses. By canceling the record of the debt that stood against us with its legal demands, this he set aside, nailing it to the cross, his cross. He disarmed the rulers and authorities and put them to open shame by triumphing over them in him. The debt is paid, canceled. Our sin, forgiven. Our enemy, defeated. We're no longer spiritually dead and subject to the law of sin and death. Now we are very much alive according to the law of the Spirit of life in Christ. Now, no longer any condemning judgment for you in Christ Jesus. Yeah? Now, I should note that although we are free from the condemning judgment in Christ, we will experience the correcting conviction of the Holy Spirit. As the Holy Spirit corrects us of sin and seeks to mold us and shape us into the image of Jesus, who is perfection. God corrects us because he loves us. When we sin, the Holy Spirit will often convict us of that sin. He reveals to us what we have done wrong. At times, it's right when we did it. At other times, it comes later. But regardless, he makes us aware that we were wrong. And when such conviction comes, we need to put into practice 1 John 1:9, which says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from some, all unrighteousness. When we're convicted by the Holy Spirit, we're to confess our fault to the Lord. You were right. You're right. I'm wrong. And he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins, to cleanse us. And we can trust that when we do that, that transaction is complete, forgiven, done. Yeah. Now, there may be some other further action that we are called to do. We may need to go to someone else and ask them for forgiveness if we have offended someone, so that we can be reconciled to them and the Lord. Yeah. We're to go to them with a heart of humility, seeking to reconcile. But as we give our failures to the Lord and act upon 1 John 1:9, we can trust that the issue is dealt with. It's done. Forgiven in God's sight. Unfortunately, there may be consequences of our actions, but the important thing to know is that we have been forgiven by God nonetheless. Okay? When the Holy Spirit convicts us, he always seeks to move us toward the Lord, towards forgiveness, to resolve the issue and make our relationship with him and others right, no longer hindered. When our enemy condemns us,
He always seeks to do the opposite, to get you to feel so condemned that you move away from God. Now, the initial sense or feeling, conviction, condemnation, our feelings can betray us. The important thing for us to do is that if we're feeling condemned or we're feeling convicted, to go to the Lord, to turn to Him in prayer. And He will give us the wisdom to know what is happening. Yeah. The important distinction is this. Condemnation always seeks to pull us away from the Lord, feeling like we can't come to Him, causing us to withdraw within ourselves, to not deal with the issue, to feel like there's no way for it to be resolved. If we embrace condemnation, we're basically saying to the enemy, "You're right, I'm horrible, I can't come to God, and I'll just wallow in my sin by myself." It's not a good place to be. That's where the enemy would love for us to be, because it puts us on the shelf. Yeah? Conviction will always draw us to the Lord for forgiveness, restoration. Condemnation drives us away from the Lord in self-pity, maybe depression, guilt. Yeah? So, maybe it's hard to discern in the moment. The best thing to do is to run to the Lord, and He is faithful. In Christ, the throne room is always open. Always open. His grace is always available. In Christ, you are God's beloved child. And He is an ever-faithful Father. He knows you, and He knows what you need best. If you need conviction, He will convict you. If you need comfort, He will comfort you. And He will provide abundantly. So, rejoice, my friends. You have been set free from any condemning judgment. There is none for you. There is none for me in Christ Jesus. No valid condemnation, whether it comes from our enemy or comes from ourselves. We are forgiven in Christ. We have been set free from the judgment and the condemnation of the law of sin and death by that greater law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. We have been set free to fly above our old sinful past, to soar above our present failures, and to keep pressing forward with the Lord. Remember that in Christ, you are a new creation. You have been set free from the bondage of your old nature and of that old law that brings condemnation and judgment. Because now we are subject to that higher law, that law of life in Christ, as we are indwelt by the Holy Spirit, who enables us to resist and to put off our old nature according to the new nature that He gives us. Yeah. Paul would write to the Philippians, "Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal of the prize, the upward call of God in Christ Jesus." Let us keep pressing forward with Jesus, leaving the things in the past in the past. The good, the bad, the ugly. Keep moving forward with Amen. Jesus. And don't let the enemy condemn you. Amen?
Amen?
There is a warning from this text. I trust that the majority of you here this morning, and if you're watching, that you have received Jesus as your Savior, and that you have been set free from the law of sin and death by the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. Set free from condemnation. But I must tell you, I would be negligent if I did not, that if you have not accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, then the law of sin and death still applies for you. It's a real law. It is as real as the law of gravity. You will face punishment for your sin. And there's nothing that you can do in yourself to get free from that. The only way that you can be free from that and gain eternal life after you die, being with God, is by turning from your sin and asking Jesus to forgive you, to come into your life and make you new, to set you free. Yeah? If that is you this morning, do not delay. God loves you. Amen. He offers you forgiveness. Now, newness of life today. We are not guaranteed tomorrow. We're not guaranteed the next hour. We're not. I implore you, if that is you, ask Jesus to forgive you. I'm going to go ahead and pray, and then I'll hand it over to Pastor Tim. Lord, we're so thankful for your goodness. Lord, your great love for us. Lord, we thank you for sending your Son to deal with all of our sin on the cross. Thank you, Lord, that because of what he has done, that when we receive you, that we are forgiven too. And that the condemnation, the judgment, no longer applies. And Lord, we cry out to you for anyone here this morning that does not know you. Lord, that they would see the reality of the situation. Lord, that they would cry out to you, asking you for forgiveness, confessing that you are Lord, that you died on the cross, paying for their sin, that you rose again from the dead, showing yourself victorious over their sin. And Lord, that you would forgive them and make them new. We thank you.
We will pass out the bread and the cup. These are, if you're not familiar with communion, this is a kind of an important moment for those who have given their hearts to Jesus. This is kind of a memorial, essentially. It's us stopping to remember the price that Jesus paid to set us free from our sins, to give us that law of life in Christ Jesus. The bread represents the body of Jesus. The cup represents his blood. These are the very real, this is the currency that God paid for our salvation with. And so even though they may seem very simple in our hands, bread and the fruit of the vine, they represent a price that we cannot even fathom, that God paid to set us free from our sins. And as a result of the seriousness of this time together, you know, the scriptures warn us that we should judge ourselves. We should, and what that means is essentially just to kind of recognize where we are in our walk with him, in our relationship with him. We don't want to turn communion into just an empty religious exercise that we do every Sunday or every once a month or whatever the case may be. This is a time where we're stopping, we're looking at these elements, remembering that God loved us so much that he was willing to leave heaven, step into this earth, live his life as a man, and to lay that sinless, perfect life down on a cross for you and for me. And the beautiful thing this morning is that if you have never given your heart to Jesus, that today could be the day. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Tomorrow is not promised to anyone. You know, funny thing about laws, I don't know if you noticed, but laws are not based upon feelings. Anybody who's gotten a ticket, you know, they always have that bewildered look on their face when the police pull them over.
Well, I don't feel like I was speeding.
Law is impartial. God is no respecter of persons. And if you're under the law of condemnation and death, that is a terrifying, fearful reality that God will deal with you according to your sin. But if you're under the law of life in Christ Jesus, God is also still no respecter of persons. Hallelujah. It doesn't matter where you've been. It doesn't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter who you are, what color your skin is, what language you speak, how much money you have in the bank, or any of that. If you have come to his son, if you have bowed the knee and said, God, I'm a sinner, save me. I believe your son is the savior upon whom we have waited. I have waited. The Bible says if you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus died, was buried, and rose again on the third day, you will be saved. And that's what we're celebrating this morning. That's what we're remembering this morning. Your servant David said, Lord, who is man that you are mindful of us? And Lord, when we think about the price that you were willing to pay to save mankind from our sins, Lord, we marvel that you would humble yourself to consider our plight. Lord, that you would humble yourself to step into our world, to live out a life as a man, tempted in all things and yet without sin. We thank you that you humbled yourself and that you laid that life down upon a Roman cross 2,000 years ago. And with your sinless life, you bore all of our sins on that cross. Every single one, even the ones we're unconscious of, Lord. You bore them all. And when you rose from the dead victorious, having conquered sin and death and the grave, Lord, you rose as the first fruits of the resurrection, a promise that belongs to all of us this morning. Not only of new life here and now, but of eternal life in the age to come. Lord, who are we that you are mindful of us? Lord, we thank you, we praise you, we worship you. Lord, we're not worthy. Lord, cleanse us and wash us from all of our sins, God. We pray this morning that as we come again to the foot of the cross and bow the knee in fresh surrender, Lord, that your power, your life, Lord, your freedom
would flood our beings this morning. Lord, the weight and cares of this world, the condemnation of the enemy, the weakness of our flesh would disappear, would be eclipsed in the beauty and the glory of who you are and all that you have done. We love you, God. We worship you. Blessed be your holy name. Father, we long for that day when we will stand in your presence, whole, complete, glorified, at rest. Until that day, Lord, strengthen our hands. Give us faith and courage for the days ahead to live our lives for you. We trust you for these things. Lord, you're the only one who can bring it to pass. Have your way. Receive this offering from us now as we receive this bread and this cup in Jesus' mighty name.
Divine, draw me close and teach me to abide. Where the Spirit leads, as I'm following, I depend on you. I depend on you for the victories still in front of me. I depend on you. I depend on you. You're the way, the truth, and the life. You're the well that runs dry. I'm the branch and you are the vine. Draw me close and teach me to abide. Be my strength, my song in the night. Be my own, my treasure, my prize. I am yours forever, you're mine. Draw me close and teach me to abide. When I pass through death, as I enter rest, I depend on you. I depend on you. For eternal life to be raised with Christ, I depend on you. I depend on you. You're the way, the truth, and the life. You're the well that never runs dry. I'm the branch and you are divine. Draw me close and teach me to abide. Be my strength, my song in the night. Be my all, my treasure, my prize. I am yours forever, you're mine. Draw me close and teach me to abide. depend on you. Oh, I depend on you. I depend on you. I depend on you. I depend on you. You're the way, the truth, and the life. You're the well that never runs dry. I mention you are the vine. Draw me close and teach me to abide.